A very good morning to Honorable Professor T. Thyagarajan and all participants across the world present here. It's my pleasure and privilege to welcome you all on this International Research Orientation Program Day 5. On behalf of MM Institute of Computer Technology and Business Management, I, Savita Vadhaman, extend very warm greetings to all of you. The relevance of collaborative relationships of universities with companies and the role of universities in the development of innovation ecosystem have attracted considerable attention in the field of economic and management. The continuous expansion of universities has opened new space and possibilities as universities are interconnected with a number of form of ecosystems such as the innovation ecosystem. Despite the acknowledgement of relevance of universities in innovation ecosystems, the understanding of how to establish and run strategic partnership between universities and companies, as well as how to manage and assess initiatives to foster companies' entrepreneurial and innovation development capacities, are still open challenge. So to get the answer of such type of questions, we have Professor T. Thyagarajan with us on the topic, A Sustainable Ecosystem for Research and Innovation in Higher Educational Institutes. It is an honor to have the opportunity to introduce our resource person of this session. He is a man of distinct vision and a fountainhead of illuminating ideas and idol of knowledge, experience, and inspiration to all of us. Professor T. Thyagarajan has received his PhD in Intelligent Control at Anna University and postdoctoral research at National Taiwan University, Taiwan. He is currently serving as the Dean of MIT campus. He served as HOD Electronic and Instrumentation for 6 years, established facility worth rupees 3 crore, secured MBA for 5 years for both UG and PG, and recognition to offer PhD under QIP. As Director University Library for 3 years, established facilities worth rupees 3 crore and secured 2 awards from IEEE and Springer 2 times for maximum uses of e-resources. As Director, CUIC facilitated campus placement for around 14,000 students, generated revenue worth rupees 6 crore, secured SEED Award for Best Industry Institute Interaction for the 2 consecutive years. He also played significant role in getting UGC UPE status with a funding rupees 22 crore for Anna University. He has published over 105 research papers, authored 4 textbooks, guided 14 PhD scholars, secured R&D funding worth rupees 13.4 crore from AICTE, DST, DIT, TEQIP, and UGC. He made technical visits to USA, UK, Spain, Italy, and all the Southeast Asian and Middle East countries. He has received so many awards, including Tamil Nadu State DTE Award for guiding Best BE Project, Sisir Kumar Award for ICE for publishing Best Research Paper, 2 Best Paper Awards in IEEE International Conferences, Best Paper Award from IEA, Shri Rajiv Gandhi Gold Medal Award from GEPRA for Outstanding Contribution in Education and Research, Dr. APJ Abdul Kalam Award from MRD Lab for Scientific Excellence, Best Industry Institute Coordinator Award from SEED, and 4 Certificate of Appreciation from IEEE. He was the youngest chairman of IEEE Madras section covering Tamil Nadu and Pondi states for 2 consecutive years during 2010 and 2011, and was the founder chairman of IEEE Control System Society. During his tenure, the section received Distinguished Last Section Award from Region 10, first of its kind in the 25 years of its existence. He is a senior member of IEEE, SAE, SSI, IE, and ISTE. Sir, we admire your spirit of integrity with 100% dedication to all the world of education, and it gives me tremendous pleasure to introduce you. We welcome you, sir, and would like to hand over the session to you. Please, sir, take over the session.
Okay, thank you, Dr. Savita ji, for your comprehensive introduction. I think you have read all the credentials. I just shared the biodata. I thought you will pick up a few points, but you have read everything. It's so nice of you. So the leadership team of the MM Institute of Computer Technology, Business and Management under the Maharishi Markandeshwar Deemed University, which is NAC A grade. That's a very outstanding performance from Ambala. And Mr. Arvind Kumarji, and my esteemed friend who is collaborating with me for this program, Mr. Dalip Ji, and other senior professors from this institute, and esteemed participants. There are around 91 participants here, and maybe others viewing through the YouTube. It gives me an immense pleasure and unique privilege to share my thoughts about establishing a sustainable ecosystem, for R&D and innovation in my 3 decades of experience, both in teaching, in research, as well as in educational administration. I thought I will pick up this topic and share my thoughts for the benefit of the fraternity from engineering and other higher education institutions. So with this introduction, I will go ahead with my presentation. Is this visible, Mr. Dalip? Is this slide visible?
Yes, sir, it is visible.
Okay. So this is the topic I'm going to talk about. And similar to your VIPGR in our schools, when we were learning our science teacher will tell, these are all the rainbow colors. And how to remember, then you have an acronym, VIPGR, violet, indigo, blue, green, yellow, orange, and red. Similar to that, so I call it a CISRI, C-S-R-I, CISRI. CISRI matlab sustainable ecosystem for research and innovation. Sustainable ecosystem, that's the challenge. You can create an ecosystem, but it must be sustainable. Whether I am in the helm of affairs or somebody else is going to take up my position later, this ecosystem should be a sustainable ecosystem for promoting, for nurturing, that is research and innovation, especially in higher education institutions. So I look at it in 3 paradigms. One paradigm is, what is that we can do in terms of academic research? Fundamentally, we start our research as a professor in an higher education institution in the form of academic research. That's how we make a humble beginning. Then how do we move to a sponsored research? Sponsored research ke liye kya karna chahiye? What is the roadmap? How we accomplish things under this basket, sponsored research? Aur aage badhne ke liye, how do we go about industrial research? That's a challenging task. The easiest task under these 3 is academic research. Theek hai, you are Madam aapka shubh naam kya ji? Swati? Madam, who introduced me?
Yes, sir, I am Savita.
Savita ji has introduced me as Professor Tyagarajan, guided 15 PhDs and published 100 papers. That's the easiest task among these 3, academic research, sponsored research, industrial research. That academic research is a bit easy compared to other things. And she also read during my introduction, I secured some 13 crores of funding. Sponsored research, okay, to some extent is okay. But friends, the challenge is industrial research. The money he spends on our research, he every week he will expect some kind of progress. So how do we go about it? So this is the preamble, friends. So to repeat again, I'm going to talk about what is the ecosystem. What is the ecosystem for research and innovation in higher education institutions? What are the steps we take to make it a sustainable ecosystem? Uske andar academic research matlab kya hai? How do you foster this? How do you nurture this? How do you promote this? Uske baad sponsor research. How do we do sponsor research? What are the agencies? How do you prepare your proposal? So that I'll spend some time. And uske baad industry oriented research. What is the expectation of the industry? How do you deliver that? How do you cope up the expectations of industry when they pump in money for the industry oriented research? So this is what, friends, I wanted to share. I'll go to the next slide. Friends, days have gone, all of you will agree with me, days have gone when we get a PhD degree, you are landing up in a position like HOD, or if you have some experience with a PhD, you will land up in a principal post. Those days have gone. Those days have gone about 2 decades back. 20 saal ke pehle, wo sab paradigm change ho gaya, badal gaya. Matlab, there is a paradigm shift in academic R&D expectation, academic research expectation. When you knock the door of a PhD scholar, if you ask him, what is your progress? Sir, I have presented my papers. Uske pehle, sir, I have completed my coursework, research coursework. Very happily, he will proffer. Then he will say, I have presented some papers in the conference. So these two are the easiest things, according to me, for a PhD scholar to claim. But friends, nowadays, if you want to publish a paper in a reputed journal, in a journal with a high impact factor, in a refereed journal, it takes nearly 12 to 15 months, mark my point. If you want to publish a paper, a quality paper, in a refereed journal, kam se kam, 12 mahine se 15 mahine tak, 12 to 15 months it takes to publish a paper. And then only you get some awarding this PhD. But the expectation did not stop with the PhD. Now, at the entry level itself in higher education institutions, the good established institutions, they expect a PhD. Whereas 2 decades back, if you have a PhD with some experience, you are landing up with a HOD post. If you have sufficient experience with PhD, you are handed over to principal post. But today the paradigm shift at the entry level, when you are applying for assistant professor, some established institutions, they ask for PhD. So what kind of ecosystem we can develop to cater to this kind of expectations by the higher education institutions? They also ask whether you have pursued postdoctoral research. After PhD, have you pursued postdoctoral research? Have you got funded projects under your name? Have you published patents? Have you developed any prototype, laboratory prototype? Then through the technology transfer with an industry tie-up, have you converted that laboratory prototype into a commercial product? Dekhiye, kahan se kahan tak expectation hai. A simple paper presentation in a conference, it moves to the product development. That is the paradigm shift we have. The landscape is totally changed. So what kind of ecosystem we can develop in a higher education institution to cater to this kind of expectation? So friends, another interesting slide, dekhiye. Academic landscape. Sometimes we ignore some of the undergraduate and postgraduate projects. There are some creamy layer students who develop very useful laboratory prototype through their UG project or PG project, or through their MS or PhD work, or through their postdoctoral work. So how do we promote that into a product? How do you promote that into a product? How do we disseminate the information that here are the research works that are going on in our campus? One thing is you conduct conferences. In most of the places when we go around as a keynote speaker for international conferences, the name alone is called international conference. There is no papers from international authors, no participation from the international research scholars. So that is not called the promoting our capability across the globe. If you say it is international conference, it should be truly international conference. Now that the virtual platform is available with so much of sophistication, IT explosion, we can make a truly international conference. Then only across the globe, people will come to know that what is happening in our institution, what kind of a research activity, what kind of thrust areas, what are the major R&D facilities we have used for our research work. These things we can showcase during conduct of this international conferences, truly international conferences. That kind of ecosystem we should develop in the higher education institution. When we conduct workshops or tutorials, it should be truly international level. There is one program under a Government of India, GIAN program, G-I-A-N. Now they are made it into SPARK, S-P-A-R-K. There is a possibility, provision for international collaboration to invite people from abroad to deliver lectures in a structured form for the benefit of the research scholars. Do we have that kind of ecosystem to cater to the change that is happening in the academic landscape? That is what the question and higher education institution administrators should keep asking themselves. Do we have that kind of ecosystem? Journal publication. At least around 30 to 40 PhD theses I would have adjudicated or examined. In some of the publications at the end, they put those names of those journals we don't see in any of the platforms like Scopus or UGC listed journals. When we say journal publication, it should be a reputed journal with the impact factor. So how do we expect our people to publish in such impact factor journals? Do we have a ecosystem? So what kind of ecosystem first you can provide? I'll come to that in the forthcoming slides. We should have access to all the standard international journals in the staff room itself through their internet or LAN or intranet. The faculty has to be able to access these top journals like IEEE transactions, around 147 transactions, ACM transactions. So this kind of a facility one should create. You can see here, ACM Digital Library, IEEE Explore, ProQuest, Science Direct, JSTAR, OpenJGate, Springer Link, UGC InfoNet, JCC. So do we have this kind of ecosystem in our higher education institution to throw open the e-resources for the benefit of the youngsters who are doing high-end research? That is what my point is here, ladies and gentlemen, higher education institution. When you expect a good quality publication, then we must facilitate this kind of facility for the benefit of the researchers. This is what I wanted to share here. Now you go back to that slide. So next is what is that, PhD supervision. Even in PhD supervision, today one scholar gets a PhD, immediately you cannot make him as a PhD supervisor. You must have some very concrete rules, the guy whether he has gone for postdoctoral research to enrich his research experience, whether he has published a paper after completing the PhD. So that will tell whether this guy has stuff to guide the PhD scholars. So that kind of ecosystem we should have, rules and regulations we should have when you want to have a quality research, to ensure quality research. Now look at this slide, very interesting slide, ladies and gentlemen. Sometime back I told you, if you want to publish a paper in a quality journal, it takes 12 to 15 months. So how that happens, you look at here, the author sends Dr. Savitaji, are you able to see the cursor?
Yes, sir. I'm able to see.
Yeah, this is the author, and the author sends the manuscript. Manuscript is received by the editor. Editor goes through the manuscript and identifies the suitable reviewers. Then the blue line, the manuscript is sent to reviewer one, manuscript is sent to reviewer two, manuscript sent to reviewer three. If it is a high impact journal, the reviewers may be five sometimes. For example, ISA, that is International Society for Automation, or IEEE, or Journal of Process Control, for example, I'm telling. So you have four reviewers, you have five reviewers. So usually they give around 2 months. And after 2 months, the editor gives a reminder. And worst case, in 3 months, the reviewer send the comments. And why I put deliberately red mark, you know, the comments will not be just like that. You are beautiful, you are excellent. But there will be critical comments about the quality of the work that you have shown in the manuscript. So the reviewer one sends this, reviewer two sends this with a red armor, reviewer three sends this, then the editor consolidates and sends in the red arrow mark to the author. And he gives around 6 months time. Uske andar wo sab agar simulation karna hai, or when any revision in the paper, all that you must be able to do within 6 months. And in turn, the author will send their hope. That's why I have put a green color, with a hope to the editor. And the editor also goes through it. Sometimes if the critical comments are there, he sends back again to the reviewer. Or sometimes, please mark my point, ladies and gentlemen, sometimes the editor sends to new set of reviewers, especially this IEEE ISA guys. They send to the new set of reviewers. And again, you get comments. Sometimes the comments will be harsh and aggressive. You may have to do additional simulations, additional schemes you may have to implement, and then compare it. So that kind of critical comments you get. And finally, friends, you see the green color. So the paper, the manuscript gets accepted and it goes to the publisher. So this is the travel a manuscript undergoes when you submit the paper to a quality journal. So this kind of ecosystem we should have when we have the, when you want to ensure the quality. So this kind of awareness we should create through our seminars for the benefit of the young research scholars. These are the process of review. So you must ensure that you do quality work. So this kind of awareness has to be created by the higher education institution for the benefit of PhD scholars periodically. Matlab, main pehle kar chuka, main kar diya, nahi chalega. Every 6 months, we should conduct this kind of program for the benefit of young PhD scholars. What is meant by refereed journal? Unko batana hai. What is meant by H index? What is meant by I-10 index? What is meant by impact factor? Citation मतलब क्या है? मेरा H index 23, उसका मतलब क्या है? Most of the scholars may not be knowing it. So we should have an ecosystem to conduct this kind of awareness program for the benefit of the young PhD scholars. That's what my point is. Friends, we should also spend quality time to apprise, to make these scholars know what is plagiarism. A simple way, I have put some 5 bullets. Taking credit for work that was not created by the scholar. Sometimes they do the second chapter modeling and then they start writing the equations. That equations are published way back. They don't cite that. This is the paper I referred for this model equations. During the presentation, during the thesis, they write or they present as if these model equations are their own findings. That is plagiarism. Make some simple changes, grammatical changes, or the order of the words. Third word comes to the first word or second word, some modifying the English and claiming it as our own word. Copy paste. Sometimes our students, out of enthusiasm, they want to present papers in the seminars while they do the Google Scholar, not even Google Scholar, sometimes they refer the Wikipedia, and there that hyperlink will also be there. And with that hyperlink, copy paste karte and present as if it is their own work. That is also not fair. Using the photographs without permission or acknowledgement, kam se kam acknowledgement to karna chahiye. So that is important. And sometimes paying an external person to write the paper on behalf of us, atrocious, not at all acceptable. So these are some of the things that we call it plagiarism. And we should have an ecosystem in our higher education institution to conduct awareness program like this. Plagiarism matlab kya hai? What all you should not do, which falls under plagiarism? And then, what are the tools we have for plagiarism, free online tools? How many PhD scholars will be knowing this? Maybe they will know Urkund. Baki sab, who will explain to them? Who can create awareness? The higher education institution should have an ecosystem to conduct this kind of awareness program, come say come once in a semester. What are all the free online plagiarism tools available? What are all the paid plagiarism tools that are available? And what are the constraints to use this plagiar? Matlab, for example, plagiarism serial number 4, only 3 scans a day. Sometimes 30 pages a month, serial number 8. Serial number 10, 500 words limitation. And serial number 6, 30 minutes waiting period. So this kind of, awareness we should create among the PhD scholars about the plagiarism. Now, friends, what are the other modes of promoting the R&D culture? A very interesting slide. This is not cut and paste from anything else. It is out of the experience after three and a half decades of service in the higher education institution. I have put some points. You need not agree with everything. It's not like a Ohm's law or Kirchhoff's law, where the law, we cannot tamper it, you cannot change it. This is out of experience. Some of the things you need not agree, you can modify accordingly. So friends, let us spend some quality time here. How do we promote R&D culture? What kind of structure you can have in higher education institution to promote R&D culture? Sometime back, I told you, you expect your scholar to publish a paper in a reputed journal. First, he must have access for that reputed journals to know how the papers are written in that. So you must provide easy access to e-resources. Can you see the cursor? Yeah, easy access to e-resources. These e-resources are costly. Some in our university, we spend almost 1 crore rupee for this. You need to provide this kind of access to, depending upon the programs you are offering in the university. If it's an MBA program, you should find out which e-resource is very standard. I'm from engineering background. I say IEEE Explorer. If it's a computer science, this your institute is a computer science, ACM Digital Library, around 45 to 48 transactions, it comes under that. So whether there is an access for that. EI Compendex, that is another e-resources for abstracts. UGC InfoNet for established institutions with a NAC grading. This UGC InfoNet is given free of cost. So whether that kind of access is there. Then comes, you have to promote a membership among the scholars, among the faculty members in some professional bodies, maybe national professional body, for example, Institute of Engineers, Indian Society for Technical Education, IETE, Institute of Electronics and Telecommunication Engineers, SSI, System Society of India, like that. International Professional Society, IEEE, ISA, ASME, ASCE, or SAE, Society of Automotive Engineers. So whether in most of those international professional bodies, the membership is not a life membership. It is annual membership, which is in dollars, which comes to around 6,000 rupees average per annum. So we must motivate the faculty members, explain to them the benefit of becoming a member in a professional society. We should create some kind of awareness programs in a structured manner to make awareness among the scholars, among the young faculty, the benefit of becoming the member of a professional body. You can also have some kind of a policy. If some research scholar is publishing quality papers, maybe we can encourage them by sponsoring the professional membership body by the institute itself. So that's some kind of motivation. Or if you want a branch counselor, student branch counselor, so that student branch counselor's membership can be sponsored by the higher education institution. So do you have that kind of policy? That's what I mean by creating an ecosystem. Then suppose a scholar is presenting a paper abroad. In abroad, at least the registration fee will be around $500. $500 matlab, you multiply by 70 rupees, approximately around 35,000 rupees. That's a huge money for a scholar. Do you have a policy for sponsoring the registration fee for the scholar, or 50% of the sponsor's registration fee? Do you have some kind of a policy in the higher education institute? Do you have a policy for giving a travel grant to enable the scholar to go abroad and present the paper? 100% travel grant, 75% travel grant, or 50% travel grant, or identify an industry who can sponsor the travel grant. So do you have that kind of a system? All the young faculty members invariably should go abroad and work for 3 months to 6 months in a R&D lab of his interest and come out with ideas to develop a similar kind of facility in our campus. So that kind of policy one can think of. If a scholar comes, if a young faculty after going abroad comes back and gives a proposal, we should have some kind of a policy to promote establishing a center of excellence. Maybe in association with the industry, or maybe in association with a funding agency, or maybe portion of the money from our own institution. So do you have that kind of policy? Any awards we are giving, if a faculty member published a paper in a high impact factor journal like Nature, sometimes the impact factor is 14, or a high impact factor above 5 if somebody is publishing on the annual day, or an institute day, or a university day, we can give some award for the such faculty members. And sometimes you get the money from the funding agency, but spending that money becomes a big challenge in many of the institutions. So have you got a simplified procurement procedure to enable the principal investigator to spend the money on time? Nowadays, the agencies, they tell very specifically for the non-consumable item like equipment purchase, you should purchase within the first year. Otherwise, you return the money back with interest. So that's the kind of stringent rules that the funding agencies say. That's why I have written this statement. Do you have a simplified procurement procedure? And any thrust areas are you identifying and forming the groups based on the thrust area? It may be interdisciplinary also. In our system, do we have a provision for the faculty to go for sabbatical for 6 months to 1 year to 2 years, maybe to an industry, or maybe for a R&D organization, or maybe for an academic institute abroad? Do you have some that kind of policy to send our faculty under sabbatical? An youngster who completes the PhD or postdoctoral works comes with a lot of enthusiasm. Sir, I want to develop this facility. Can you give me a seed money? I will also try to get money from the other agencies and industry, but I need a seed money. Can the higher education institution support this? Of course, PhD scholars get the fellowships from various agencies. In coming slides, I will show that. In case a student is not getting the fellowship, in the institute, do we have a fellowship for the research scholar? Maybe to the tune of 20,000 per month to start with. Do we have a structured awareness program, conduct of awareness programs? So this is what I mean by creating a sustainable ecosystem for the academic research, friends. Savitaji, so this is what is the slide I was talking about, the academic research. We can also provide facilities like a repository, resources like IEEE Explorer, eResource, ProQuest, Science Direct, ACM Digital Library. Like this, we need to provide, create this kind of a system. And okay, so this is what I wanted to share under the academic research before I go for the sponsored research, and uske baad I go for the industry oriented research. I can take a couple of questions now. It's almost 40 minutes I started the lecture, and I covered what kind of ecosystem we can have to promote academic research in the changing landscape. I can have a few questions based on this. Then I will go for the sponsored research promote karne ke liye, what kind of ecosystem you should develop. And after that, I spend some time on industry research. Over to Dr. Savita. So somebody has typed some questions through messages. You can ask one or two questions. Over to Dr. Savita.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, what kind of, any questions you can have, And
So
I
actually,
can
we have a question answer round, and we will ask all the questions written by the participants at the end of the session, sir, in the question answer round.
You have planned like that.
Yes, sir.
You have planned like that. Theek hai,
yes,
theek
sir.
Theek hai. So shall I continue?
Yes, sir. Sure.
So do you have a question, Dr. Savita ji?
No, sir.
Okay.
I will ask all the questions at the end of the session.
At the end.
We will not disturb you in between.
Okay. It is easy to deliver a lecture, but it is difficult to listen for continuously a lecture. So I thought for a change before I switch over to even in a cinema theater or a beautiful movie like Badla or like some very interesting movie, they give an interval so that you recharge and come back. So that's the concept. Anyway, I'll proceed with the second portion. The second portion is sponsored research, what kind of ecosystem we can develop. Esteemed fraternity, you will agree with me that whatever the research we pursue, that should help the society. End of the day, it should help the society, because the money we get, the sponsored money we get from the R&D agencies is taxpayers' money. So whatever we need, we do our research, end of the day, that research should help the system, should help the society, to help the common man, help the people who are deprived of this kind of amenities. So that should be the bottom line. You all agree with me. So if you look at that, I suggest these five major areas based on the experience I have, based on the knowledge I acquired listening to so many top people in higher education. The first and foremost thing is healthcare. That's the important R&D area one should focus, healthcare. Then the agriculture. Then the third one, the clean water. And of course, the energy. I think there is a spelling mistake there. E-N-E-R-G-Y, energy. And finally, environment. Environment. Again, like VIPGR, if you want to remember this, you remember HACCE. H-A-C-E-E, H for healthcare, A for agriculture, C for clean water, E for energy, another E for environment. So you can think of these major areas, and you can plug in your technology, your expertise, your domain expertise, and see that something comes out in these five areas. Then I call it as socially conscious research. For example, chatbots, natural language processing, energy storage, additive manufacturing, sensors and wearable devices, predictive analytics, advanced materials. I'll throw some more light. All of you have heard about this, Dr. Abdul Kalam ji. Incidentally, I'm serving as a dean of the institute where Dr. Abdul Kalam ji pursued his aeronautical engineering. When the small kids suffering from polio, they were not able to walk, and they used to use a gadget which is a very heavy gadget, which is weighing a few kilos. Dr. Abdul Kalam ji saw that how can we address this problem without compromising the other requirements for that gadget. Then he used some advanced materials. He reduced the weight much lesser than the actual weight And that is the kind of socially consciousness as one should aim at. In our campus, we are known for drones, indigenously made drones. When this COVID came, where the places are not accessible, the disinfection was spread using our own drones. So that's the kind of a socially conscious research. When these drones are also used to spread the pesticides in agriculture land, when it was affected by the worms. So that kind of application-oriented, society benefit-oriented research, that's what I'm suggesting here. Clean water, environment. Very recently, we have developed an automatic external defibrillator. Hitherto, it is all imported. The indigenously developed, which is in the process of a commercial product after ethical clearance, will be nearly one third of the actual cost of the AED, automatic external defibrillator, which is going to be imported. So that is actually, you can see in airports, if somebody gets a heart attack, then you apply that AED and see that he is revived. So that kind of socially conscious research one has to. What kind of thrust areas we can think of? AI, artificial intelligence, can we use it for a common man's purpose? Blockchain, very recently I read in the newspaper, the blockchain technology is used for farmers to plan their selling up of the vegetables, blockchain technology. Cyber security, cloud computing, design thinking, drones, e-learning, edge computing, fintech, financial technology, generative design, autonomous vehicle, of course, e-vehicle, autonomous vehicle, connected vehicle, this is the order of the day, IoT, IIoT, industry IoT, remote sensing, robotics, social media, virtual and augmented reality. So these are some of the thrust areas that comes in my mind with the engineering background, but other disciplines you can think of that. Just 1 minute, please. And friends, yeah. So I was telling you sometime back, if a research scholar applies for a PhD, unless he gets some financial support, it is difficult for him to stay for 3 to 4 to 5 years to do his research. So what are the fellowships we have? So if you look at this, I started with our government fellowships, DST, Department of Science and Technology, DBT, Department of Biotechnology, CSIR or DSIR, and Scientific and Industrial Research, and the SERB Research Fellowships, J.C. Bose National Fellowship, Ramanujam Fellowship, Boys Cost Postdoctoral Fellowship. It's a very prestigious fellowship, Boys Cost Fellowship. SERP National Postdoctoral Fellowship, PDF Matlab Postdoctoral Fellowship. And then ISRO Respond Fellowship, Empowerment and Faculty Opportunities for Excellence in Science. This is for the faculty. And if you see under UGC, you have JRF, you have Dr. Kothari Postdoctoral Fellowship, Dr. Radhakrishnan, and then Startup Grant for Young Scientists, Early Career Research Award Scheme, CSIR Young Scientist Award, Scheme for Young Scientists and Technologists, and IYBA Innovative Young, IYBA Matlab, Innovative Young Biotechnology Award. They give some fellowship, DBT, JRF, DBT, TWAS Postdoctoral Fellowship, Indo-US Fellowship exclusively for women, Nehru Fulbright Fellowship, Fulbright Kalam Fellowship, JSPS, DAD Fellowship. So how we can enable our PhD scholars to apply for this? So you need to have an ecosystem in the higher education institution. This information should be periodically disseminated for the benefit of young faculty, for the benefit of the PhD scholars. One step ahead, with all these trials, if the scholar is not getting the fellowship, can the institute think of giving some kind of fellowship for those scholars, institution level? Friends, then comes the sponsor research. Nowadays, every head of the higher education institution asks the faculty members during their reviews, performance appraisals, do you have a sponsored research project? So that's an easy question, but the answer is very difficult. So my suggestion is, do we have some kind of a hand-holding by the senior colleagues in the higher education institutions to help the young faculty members to apply for sponsored research? So how do we do that? You need to provide some mentoring for the young faculty by the seniors. If a young faculty comes out with a project proposal, we should have some hands-on training to prepare proposals. If you see in the website, there is a call for proposals from DST, then immediately that information should be spread across all the departments. You should have an ecosystem like that. Then one day workshop by inviting some senior professors who have got so much of funding or experience in getting funding projects to deliver lectures on how to prepare a proposal. Maybe it can be in the form of a workshop. In the morning, they discuss how to prepare a proposal. In the afternoon, in the workshop, the young faculty will prepare a proposal itself. Then, how do we present the proposal in front of an expert committee? Expert committee usually will have people from knowledgeable people from very high educational institutions, from IITs, IISc, IITs, and some reputed state universities, NITs. So how do we make presentation in front of that? Hardly they give 10 to 15 minutes. So do we have an ecosystem to pull in all these presenters, make mock presentation internally, give some kind of inputs, how to fine-tune that proposal, how to fine-tune the PPT, what are the expectations of that expert committee? Sometimes they ask, do you have a tie-up with an R&D organization? Do you have a tie-up with an industry? Is the project interdisciplinary? What is the deliverable? What is the outcome? Will the outcome be helpful to the society? Have you done the market survey? Have you done whether a commercial product can be brought out? So these kind of inputs, if we can give to the young faculty members, then the proposal, they can fine-tune it, present it well, and see that if not the first attempt, in the second or third attempt, they will be able to get the funded project. Otherwise, simply asking a question in the review meetings or in the performance appraisals, do you have funded project? What the young faculty can do? He only will say, sir, I have submitted 15 proposals. Apply, no reply. So that's not going to help the faculty member. So that's where I'm coming into picture. The higher education institution should have a structured way of doing this kind of activity to promote sponsored research proposal submission. And friends, This is another interesting slide. The higher education institution should network with all the stakeholders who are doing the R&D. First and foremost thing is with the government agencies. That means like your DST, DBT, UGC, AICTE, CSIR, like that. Then we should have some kind of tie-up with the academic institutions, matlab in the area. For example, the organizer of this program is from Ambala. So in and around that there is in Chandigarh, there is one CSIO, if I am right. So like that, can we identify the R&D organizations and the academic institutions which are having high ranking with the NIRF or NAC or QS ranking? Can we have tie-up with that academic institution? Not for funding alone, even for mentoring, even giving for some guidance, even to share an information that DSD is calling for a proposal. So who will tell that? The faculty members are busy with their teaching load, laboratory load, question paper setting, evaluation, invigilation, class advisor work, parent-teacher meeting, and preparing a laboratory manual. There are so many other activities. So how they will come to know that there is a proposal, call for proposal? So the tie-up with a reputed academic institution, you can find some mentors. They can share the information periodically that, look here, AICT is called for proposals. Look here, DST is calling for proposals. The last date is this. These are the thrust areas. Please prepare some proposal. So that kind of information you can get when you have tie-up with the higher education institutions. Then from R&D organizations, if you want some joint proposals, we can have tie-up with R&D organizations and plan for joint proposals. We can also have networking with the professional bodies. When you are conducting international conferences, then if it is sponsored by a professional body like IEEE, it adds value. The shortlisted papers you can upload in the IEEE digital library. If you have that provision, then you get you receive very good papers from established institutions. See how the quality is coming up. So you need to have some network with the professional body. If you are aiming for a industry-oriented research, you should have a tie-up with a core industry or IT industry. So this slide tells us what kind of networking an higher education institution can think of. Initially, informal networking. Once, if both parties feel that there is a mutual benefit, you can formalize this networking with the help of a letter of intent or with the help of a memorandum of agreement or with the help of memorandum of understanding. We call it LOI, you call it MOA, you call it MOU. So this is the kind of structure a higher education institution should think of to promote sponsored research or industry-oriented research. All these should happen in a structured form. I repeat the word again, again, again. It should not be ad hoc. Chalo bhai, Mr. Sharma is interested, so he goes and tie up with R&D. Sharma is transferred to some other campus under that university. So this will become dormant. So whether it is X or Y or Z, we should have a sustainable ecosystem. Men may come and men may go, but the ecosystem activity goes on forever. So that's how we should plan, friends. So next slide tells you, we should also facilitate this kind of information, share this kind of information for the benefit of the young faculty. Generally, if you ask the young faculty in the interview, what are all the funding agencies? they'll tell around 3 or maximum 6 AICTE, UGC, DST. They stop with that. At the most, they go one step ahead, CSIR, DBT, sometimes they say DRDO. But you have n number of funding agencies. For example, if you take a Department of Core, it doesn't mean that only I don't have that branch or a discipline I'm offering a course. It's not like that. Now it is interdisciplinary. A blockchain technology can be used in the Department of Core or data analytics or artificial intelligence. It can be used in any area. So that is how we should look at it, rather than simply looking at the name atomic energy mein mera kaam kya hai aisa kabhi nahi sochna hum. We have to go through the website, see what the research is going on and whether our domain expertise is able to help in their research work, whether we can have some collaborative work. So all these things, we should have a center, a research promoting center, who should do this kind of promotional activities. Look here, ISRO is there, and then the Ministry of Environment Forest is there, and you have food processing industry, renewable energy, CPRI, Central Power Research Institute, Water Resources, Ministry of Water Resources, and of course UGC is there, Petroleum Conservation Research and Association. So like that, you have a lot of funding agencies. So I just put some 2022 funding agency to tell that it is not only 5 or 6 what majority of the young faculty are aware of. So higher education institution should take some steps to create the awareness. So friends, and another, so far I talked about the national funding. 90% of the institutions, the young faculty may not be knowing the details on under international funding, like our Erasmus, like our JSPS, like our DAD, like UKRE, like our FINRA, that is a French National Research Agency, UNESCO, Indo-Norway, Indo-Italian, Australia, Indo-Canadian. So there, this kind of awareness program, not only sharing the link, we should do, one of us should do the homework, telling that open the link, identify the thrust areas, identify the people who are working there, identify the dates when you have to submit it, what is the amount he is restricting, what are the kind of deliverables he is expecting. This homework we should do at our end, institutional end, and then prepare a PPT, conduct awareness program, interested people can form groups and then submit the proposals. All this we cannot expect the faculty to do that. That's what I mean, we need an ecosystem. Then comes industry-oriented R&D. Industry-oriented R&D is a big challenge, friends. It's really a big challenge. Just like that, an industry will not give us money. Every paisa they spend, they expect a deliverable. And that deliverable on time, har ek hafte mein review meeting rahega, whether it is a Miladi Nabi day or whether it is a some other festival day, there will be business. Industry gives money means they mean business. Nothing is free as far as industry project is concerned. So how do we knock the door of industry to get some kind of funding? Suddenly you ask for some funding for establishing a facility, industry will not give. You have to develop step by step. So what is the step? We can request for some fellowship for our PhD scholars. Matlab monthly fellowship to the tune of around 20,000 per month for 3 years. They can frame the guidelines, they can select the people based on merit, but they can give at least 2 fellowships or 3 fellowships or 5 fellowships to start with. And after giving that fellowship, you can tie up their R&D wing with the PhD supervisor from our end and do the collaborative research. Can you see here? Collaborative research. We can have a joint supervision. Then it leads to joint publication and joint patent. Sometimes the facilities to carry out the research may be available in our place or may be available in the industry end. So can we have sharing of facilities? Can we invite them with PhD qualification as examiners for examining our PhD work, so then they come to know the quality of the work we are doing? Can we conduct in association with industry a joint conferences? With all this, if you can impress upon them, then we can request for money to establish a state-of-art R&D lab or the so-called center of excellence. For example, Autodesk, or for example, Temenos. Recently in our university, we established a facility, FinTech lab, with Temenos funding. Now it is in the pipeline. We are establishing a generative design lab with the help of Autodesk. They give the software worth several crores. And you know, Chennai is an automobile hub. We have tie up with all the automobile giants, whether it is Renault Nissan, whether it is Daimler, whether it is Ford. We conduct training programs for their industry person. They give R&D projects for our faculty. They also give vehicles free of cost as a demonstration purpose, or to do R&D on the two-wheeler or four-wheeler engines. So this is the kind of a win-win kind of tie-up we can have with the industry friends. Again, it should be win-win situation. Their R&D problems, we address it. While addressing that, we give our PhD scholar. That PhD scholar fellowship, industry gives. The publication that comes, joint author is there. The patent that comes, you can claim joint patent. So there must be some kind of a memorandum of understanding with the industry and the institute. So what I mean is, so you should have that kind of a ecosystem. Then this will happen just like that. Then what are the other collaborations you can have with the industry? Consultancy and the testing. Then technology transfer. I developed an elaborative prototype. Making multiple units, making a commercial product is not my scope because I'm a professor. So I join hand with the industry, and here you have a technology transfer. And this there must be a cell in the higher education institution to promote the technology transfer in a structured way. Matlab, there must be royalty. That royalty should go to institute. The royalty should go to the faculty member who does the technology transfer, and that should lead to product development and commercialization. So this kind of ecosystem we should have with a formal memorandum of understanding with industry. Then only the project what we do should go to the field, will go to the society in the form of a commercial product. On the simplified form of connectivity with industry, we can have a compendium. Compendium matlab, you have several departments. Each department has got its own high-end facility, expertise. And you can prepare a booklet, compendium, consolidating all this expertise, contact person, and upload in your website, or that e-form of that compendium can be shared with all the industry and R&D organization. Whenever they have some problem, they go through this compendium and identify whether they have a solution, expertise, specialty in this institute, and they knock the door. So that is what I mean by compendium. Another kind of industry sponsorship is to develop a technology business incubation or a startup or an entrepreneur development. So can we have some tie-up with industry in this angle? Knowledge exchange, you know what I mean by that. Mentoring by the industry profession for our students, for our young faculty, for our PhD scholars. Can we conduct a joint exhibition with industry, an open house with industry to show our showcase our facilities, and then do the collaborative activities on mutually benefit basis. So these are some kind of structures through which we can establish the collaboration with the industry. Then comes the innovation. So how do we promote innovation in product development? These are some thoughts. Just I got it through our experience. It need not be followed in toto like this, but you can add on to this. So fundamentally, how do you promote innovation? For example, bank of innovative ideas. You should create a bank of innovative ideas, throw open through website for the benefit of the students to explore R&D in that areas. Can we send our UG, PG students a summer internship for R&D labs in India and abroad? In association with the industry, can we conduct hackathon, mobathon, codathon kind of programs, keeping that hockey in mind? Hockey matlab that the healthcare, agriculture, clean water, energy, environment, these are the base areas. Can we conduct some hackathon, mobathon, codathon kind of events, promote innovation among the student community? Competitions sponsored by professional bodies and industries. Can we leverage alumni, their expertise in nurturing creativity and innovation among our students? Then create incubation centers, startups, skill gym. That's another interesting area. Skill gym, sometimes they call it a maker's lab, or sometimes they call a innovation factory. It depends. So what is that you can do there? Catch hold of some industry or some funding agency to create facility like a 3D printer, a laser cutter, an engraver, a plasma cutter, a CNC mill, CNC lathe, PCB machine, a data logger, or a CRO or a DSO or analyzer, or any kind of measuring instruments with the tools, machine tools, and throw open that facility for the students 24/7. Let them spoil it. Still, some product will come out. Like this automobile students, they participate in this SAE-based competitions, like Baja, like go-kart. So where they get a facility to fabricate these things? So this skill gym will help. This maker's lab will help. Do we have that kind of ecosystem in higher education institutions to throw open this facility for the benefit of students to nurture innovation in creating laboratory prototypes and products? So that's what is the message I wanted to share, friends. Who can all help? Alumni can be leveraged. Industry can be leveraged, R&D organization can be leveraged. Industry, that the CSR fund, matlab corporate social responsibility funds. And now, recently, the government of India has told that fund can be used even for nurturing R&D. The higher education institutions should knock the door of the industry to tap that money, create this kind of ecosystem and facility to promote innovation. That's what I wanted to share in this slide. Our friends, Dr. Savita, can I share a video? A small video?
Yes, sir, you can.
Where is that share? You are presenting. Okay. I'll continue that one. I have one more slide to present. I'll present this one and then go to that video. Can you see this slide, Dr. Savita?
Yes, sir. The screen is visible.
This is what is the structure I am proposing. I am basically a process control engineer, so I put some block diagram like this, but you can do anything. Here is that sustainable ecosystem. So you have networking with the government agencies, you have network with academic, R&D, and industry institutions, industry collaborations, academic institution, art. So here comes this side is about our own higher education institution. In this, you have departments, you have center of excellences. Sometimes if it is a big institution, you have different campuses. So they all become the part of it. Each of this department, you need to promote academic R&D, sponsored R&D, and extension activity in association with industry. Then at the higher education institution level, you should have this kind of cells, innovation cell, IPR, intellectual property rights cell, then UIC, then you have TDT, technology development and transfer. This IC matlab incubation centers. So you should have this kind of structure. There must be exchange of information from this end as well as this end, and get inputs from government agencies and the other collaborative agencies. And the CESRI should be a facilitator for promoting R&D and innovation. So I close this guy, then I come back here, present now. So a window, oh, this guy is not there. I go here again, present now, the entire screen. This guy is not come, okay. So this is the video I have. How do I share this video? Can you see the video, ma'am?
No, sir.
Wait a minute.
You are presenting, sir.
Okay. Let me see whether I'm able to show the video. Otherwise, we'll stop there. I'm trying to share the video. Yeah, this is the screen. Okay, present now the entire screen. Oh, there is some problem for sharing the video. Okay. So this is the screen. Okay. This is the screen. So present now. Prompter. Okay, Dr. Savita, I'll make a last trial. If it's not working, I just stop this one. It's not coming there. Okay, Chikanji, don't worry. So I take few questions before I wind up. Over to Dr. Sarita.
Yes, sir, this is over from your side.
Ji?
Your presentation will be over, sir.
Yeah, I'm not able to present this video. I don't know why. I opened the video and kept it in my desktop, and it's available. Now I go to this one and present now. I click the entire screen, your entire screen. So usually it should display there. Why it's not displaying? I share it. I'm not able to display it. There's some problem. Chicken. Don't worry, ma'am.
Okay, sir. Now please minimize your browser screen.
Okay.
Minimize
the browser. Kar diya.
And sir, first present. First go to present now.
Present now.
Entire screen.
Entire screen. Yes.
Sir, wait for a while. It will be presenting. Wait. It is presenting.
It is not showing that video which I opened.
Sir, wait. I am saying, first of all, go to present now. Select entire screen. Click on OK.
Okay. Now I click share.
Okay.
It is not coming.
Now wait for a while. Now minimize the browser screen.
Minimize the browser. Okay.
Now your desktop is available. Now start the video.
Acha. Let me see that.
Hi, sir.
Are you able to see?
Yes, sir.
Your audio is on.
Please increase the volume.
Yeah. Are you able to listen? Audio?
No, sir. Audio is not. I'm not able to get the audio right
okay,
now.
Okay, don't worry, gentlemen. I faced a similar problem when it is Google. Actually, we should go to the YouTube. From there, I should do that. It will come. But people will get bored when I try that now. Okay. So actually, what I should do is here. Don't worry. I think I'll close it. And I'm ready for a few questions. I'm ready to answer for a few questions.
Okay, sir. Thank you so much for providing the detailed knowledge about academic research, industry research, and ecosystem. And definitely the today's session will be helpful for the participants to understand more about the ecosystem and to promote research and development culture. And sir, what's about the question? First, I would like to take the questions which we already have from the participants while filling the registration form. And the first question is this, sir. How to maintain a sustainable ecosystem for research and innovation in higher education institute, and what is its significance?
How to maintain? That is what I covered for one and a half hours. How to maintain is what I covered for one and a half hours.
They want to know about its significance.
If we don't do R&D in higher education institution, we have to close higher education institution. That is the order of the day. If we don't do research in higher education institution, we will miss the bus in the among the stakeholders.
Fine, sir.
So it is the order of the day.
Okay.
For higher education institution, of course, the primary job is teaching, but at the same time, we should involve in research and innovation. If we don't catch that research bus and innovation bus, the stakeholders, among the stakeholders kon hai? Parents, students, alumni, your recruiters, the funding agency, all this will forget you. So you have to catch research and innovation bus at the earliest. Okay. Yeah, next question, please.
Sir, next question is, how can we improve our ecosystem through simple innovations?
Simple innovation, matlab, you should have some innovation hub, innovation club, innovation clubs, students clubs. And that clubs can be with the second year, third year, fourth year student, if it is a 4-year program. This first to fourth year guy goes, then the second year, first year to second year, that guy will come in. So that structure remains same. So at any point of time, you will have that second year guys, third year guys, and fourth year guys. And those, you must put a faculty in charge for that. You can have some mentors from industry, alumni, and senior retired people, professors. And you should have some activity, weekly activity, based on any of the areas I suggested, for example, healthcare, for example, agriculture, for example, energy, environment, clean water, that kind of thing. And we throw open the bank of ideas, and the students will start working on that, initially with simulation, later with a laboratory prototype. And you should give some kind of seed money, maybe around 10,000 or 15,000 for the best team. And they will prepare some laboratory prototype. And whenever the industry conducts some competitions, whenever the professional body conducts this kind of competitions, we should promote this team to project there. They get award. So this is a kind of, that's how the positive energy goes. I hope I answered the question. Next question, please.
Sir, next question we have regarding funding projects. What are the steps are to be taken?
Who has asked that question?
This is by Dr. Sai Ram, Electronic and Communication Department, NMAI MIT.
Yeah, your institute? It's from your institute or other institute?
Sir,
it is from other institute, sir.
Okay. Actually, Dr. Sai Ram ji, I spent a lot of time and slides during my presentation, how to get funding. That's your question? How to get funding? That's the question?
Yes, sir.
I have told you so many slides I have shown. First thing, yes, is we should create what are all the agencies that give funding, and also we should conduct a program with the help of a senior professor who has already got funding to, sir, tell how to write the proposal, what is, yes, the expectations, sir, there. Uske baad the faculty will prepare the proposal. Wo proposal ko hum scrutiny karna hai, presentation ko hum mock presentation ka, dekhna hai, inputs dena hai, uske baad ye fine tune karta hai. That is also, I think I spent quality time on that. So you ask a specific question, I will answer.
Sir, how exactly keen, sir, to get the funding? That's very, because all these things we did, sir. Just a keen point, please tell me, sir. Keen. What are the things to be there? Because the acceptance concern, sir.
To get the funding?
Yes, sir. Acceptance, sir. Final acceptance, that is.
Okay. Actually, yes. That's a good point. Now I got what is in your mind.
Yes,
see,
sir,
if I write a proposal in a particular area, for example, healthcare, I am writing a proposal.
Yes, sir.
Okay. I am developing a gadget which will be an import substitute. So it will be cost effective, indigenous. So you please give me funding. Like that, I prepare a proposal. So yes, first, sir, what they see is whether I have the previous proven expertise, matlab kya hai, whether I have a good publication in that area,
yes, sir,
whether I have the expertise, that is one thing they will see. Second thing is whether I have collaborated with any industry which can take this the outcome of this project to a commercial product. That also they will see.
Yes,
and whether in terms of using their facility or in terms of some financial assistance for about a few lakhs from their side. So that also they will see. Next thing is whether we have done any market survey to promote this after completing the project, whether it can go to the market, whether we have done that kind of survey. So these are some of the things they see. Some tie up with the industry, some funding from the industry, market survey, our expertise, whether we are able, whether we have done similar kind of work in this area, whether we can claim that I am an expert in this area, whether suppose you are doing a healthcare product, whether we have a tie up with a doctor.
Yes, sir.
Dr. Sairam, you will agree with me. Whether we have a tie-up with a doctor, because I'm an engineer.
Yes, sir.
And simply talk something, but end of the day, the doctor will say, "Eh, nahi chalega."
Yes, sir.
So whether we have a tie-up with a doctor of that area, if it is, I did something on a defibrillator, so I had a tie-up with a cardiologist. So yes, these are the things that Dr. Sairam, they will look at it. It's a good question, sir. Sairam. I got
it. Romba nandri, sir. Thank you very much for your valuable information. And recently, I got the award for research publication from Government of Karnataka, sir.
Oh, Karnataka is in the Matarta.
How do you, sir?
How college is the
name? NMIMIT Nitte, sir. Karnataka Udupi district, sir.
Okay.
Yes, sir. Near to NIT Suratkal, sir. Yes, sir.
Suratkal, acha.
Yes, sir.
Near Suratkal. Yes. I hope I would answer your question, Professor.
Thank you, sir. Yeah. Thank you very much, sir, for your kind answer.
Yeah. Over to Dr. Savita ji.
Okay. Thank you, sir. And next participants want to know about the double blind peer review.
Okay. Tell me what exact specific question they can ask. Specific question. Savita ji, please permit me to take tea. You will not be able to give tea because it is a virtual meeting. It is coffee, it's not tea. Okay. Tell me, madam, a specific question. If they ask a specific, no, Dr. Sairam asked a very specific question.
Okay, sir. Okay.
How to make the presentation a successful presentation? So, what is the expectation by the committee? So, I try to answer with my knowledge.
Fine, sir.
Like that, specific question.
Fine, sir. And one participants actually want to ask, are all these fellowship or industry funding available for unaided ad hoc contractual faculties or not? If yes, what are the norms for the same?
Yeah, that's a very good question. So he says what kind of faculty he says? What is the category faculty? He told?
Unaided ad hoc and contractual faculties.
Yeah, that is a challenge. I agree with him. It depends on how your institute policy is. If your institute says, till we get a permanent faculty, we are having this ad hoc faculty. If the ad hoc faculty is there for a 5 years tenure, some kind of formula they can work out. For them, the fellowship can be given. ऐसा कुछ policy बन सकते हैं, मतलब win-win situation. So most of these institutions, sometimes the ad hoc faculty will be there even for 10 years, 15 years also. But unfortunately, they're still under that category. So we have to help them, we have to promote them, we should encourage them, we should handhold them. All these words comes from a heart. They should not be deprived of some opportunities. So the institution can work out a policy. If the ad hoc faculty is 5 years, still is there in our campus, for such people, we can give all this kind of benefit. Aisa kuch ban sakte. I agree with them. I endorse their views. But some encouragement should be there for that category of faculty also. Next question, please.
Okay, sir, thank you. And next question is, do we have any repository for submission of the research project and in open access?
That's a good question. You have the repository for ideas. not for the project report. You have a bank of ideas. There is one institute in Vizag. I am not able to quickly get the name of the institute. Some Abdul Kalam, something like that in Vizag. So they have thrown open bank of ideas. What are all the ideas where they can think of preparing research proposals? That idea bank is available, not the research report itself. You know, how people can submit that? It will become an intellectual property. No, ideas bank is there, not the proposal bank. Next question, please.
Fine, sir. And next is, how universities help scholars to promote their research in abroad also? How universities help scholars to promote their research in abroad?
How the university can support scholars to do research abroad? That's the question?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So actually, they can create some awareness programs. University can create an awareness program, or they can have one cell exclusively to promote international research. So that cell, what they should do? They should do the homework by seeing. I have shared some slides now, that UKRE I told you, Erasmus I told you, then Indo-Norway, Indo-France, Indo-Australia, Indo-US, that Fulbright, Nehru Fulbright. So these advertisements, that cell has to check periodically in the websites and put up in the notice board for the benefit of the scholars. Scholars cannot spend time for all these things because they are busy with their PhD work. So there must be a cell. There must be a center or cell. They should promote this kind of activity. If any fellowship is there, I told the JSPS fellowship, I told the DAD fellowship, I told the BISCAS fellowship. BISCAS fellowship, you can avail and you can go abroad and do the research. This Nehru Fulbright fellowship, you can avail and you can go abroad and do it. So this kind of facilitation university can create for the benefit of scholars to pursue international research. That's what is the point. Next question, please.
So next is, do we need compulsory publication in the area of project proposal?
Yeah, that will add value, ma'am. That will add value. Otherwise, how you can convince the expert team? There are so many applications you get. So how do I shortlist a survey? For example, Dr. Sairam from Karnataka. So he has applied some project. So he, let me say, I am in the committee. I will check whether Sairam ji has got the publications in this area in good journals. So he has an edge over the others. When I take a decision, does that will help. Or some kind of industry tie-up. Or some kind of already funded projects in this area. If Sairam ji has got funded projects already availed in this area, then that becomes an edge. So it's a value addition. It's a value addition.
Okay, sir. All these are the relevant queries we have, and it is requested to participants, if you have any query, please write in the chat box. Sir, one more query is here. Can foreign funding agency provide fund to Indian researchers during research in India?
Ji haan. Yes. I shared one slide now. So thus we will do that. For example, Indo-Norway. I write a proposal. While implementing that proposal, I need scholars. So the money I get from Norway through Indo-Norway project, I use it to do the project with the help of my PhD scholar. The scholar gets money for fellowship. Scholar gets money for buying the consumable items to do the research. Scholar gets money to buy that equipment to do the research. It's like that. Directly money will not go to them. The money goes to the university based on the proposal, comes to the principal investigator, investigator in turn will spend that money towards the purchase of equipment, towards the purchase of consumables, towards the purchase of high-end books needed, towards the scholars' fellowship. It's like that. I think I've answered the question.
Okay, sir. Yeah. And participants, if you have any other query, please write in the chat box. So I think so. No, there is no more query. And now, on behalf of MMICTBM, I would like to thank our speaker, Professor T. Thyagarajan, for incredible presentation and making this session a very meaningful and fascinating. We hope all the participants will get benefit from the knowledge provided by you. And also, I would like to thank all the participants for their presence and cooperation in this session. And there is one announce for the next session. Next session will be start at 3 p.m. sharp on Research Ethics and Integrity by Dr. Utpal Bora, IIT Guwahati, with Mr. Arvind Sharma as moderator. And now I request to all the participants, please switch on your camera for a group photo.
Before that, Savita, I just want to share a couple of words. Yes, and there are around 70 participants. It's almost nearing the lunchtime, but still people are eagerly listening.
Yes, sir, I hope 70 are in meet, and how many participants are in YouTube also, sir? YouTube and Facebook.
I hope they are listening. Okay. Yes, so let me conclude by recalling the nice words of Francis Bacon. It is not what we eat that makes us strong. It's what we digest that makes us strong. It's not what we read that makes us knowledgeable. It is what we understand that makes us knowledgeable. It's not what we earn that makes us rich. It's what we save that makes us rich. And finally, he says, friends, it is not what we preach in forums like this that makes us professional. It is what we practice that makes us professional. So we should practice what we preach. That's the bottom line. I profusely thank the leadership team of this great institute for giving me an opportunity to share my thoughts. And I also thank Dr. Savitaji for moderating this event. And I appreciate the enthusiastic participants for patiently listening to my lecture through webinar for almost 2 hours and answering questions. And it was very lively and participative. Bahut shukriya.
Thank you for your kind words and motivating us. And participants, please open your webcam for a pic.
Yeah, can you take so many pictures? 70 or not?
Sir, I want. Just a minute, sir. Please, participants, switch on your camera.
I think they're all ready for their lunch.
It may be, sir. Lunch time is here.
And already you announced the afternoon session, so they need a break.
Okay, sir. Thank you so much, and for your inspirational speech. Thank you so much, participants. Thank you, sir.
Yeah, if any specific feedback is there, you can share by mail. That will help me to improve my future lectures. Thank you very much, Dr. Savita Ji and other team members. Oh, Dr. Sairam is here.
Yes, sir. Vanakkam, sir.
Vanakkam, Sairam Ji. Tumba santosha nimma nodiddu, nimma jatheyalli mataadiddu, nimma question ge answer maadiddu tumba santosha.
Khandita, sir. Namaskaram, sir. Thank you.
Vidyaji is from your institute. Vishnu Ji is from your institute. There is one madam, Lata Ji, all from your institute, Savita Ji, or they are from different departments?
Sir, they are from different they are from different institute, also from the different countries.
Acha.
Not only from India.
Bahut acha organized kiya hai. Theek hai. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much.
Fir milenge.
Okay,
thank you, sir.